Ejiro Asiwu. As he talks on TypeScript Nirvana, frictionless development with unified type system. Ejiro Asiwu is a product engineer who works at the intersection of software, product, and design. He's bullish on leveraging technology to solve user problems and create magical experiences. Focusing ruthlessly on what users care about, he's also a co-founder and product engineer at Veet. Amazing. Please, a round of applause for Ejiro.
Thank you very much. Right. Thank you, everyone. Today has been quite interesting for me personally. I've learned a lot from all of the speakers. I'm here to learn also. I want to use this opportunity to thank the organizers. Kelvin is doing an amazing job. I mean, when I asked him, do you have any sponsors? And he was like, nah, we don't want any sponsors right now. I'm like, that's amazing. And he told me the reason behind it, and it's rare in the tech ecosystem because everyone's out there looking for themselves alone. But let's give a shout out to Kelvin. He's doing an amazing job. Okay. Now let's start. For my talk, I'm going to talk about TypeScript. I titled it TypeScript Nirvana, Frictionless Development with Unified Type System. So before I start, I understand that a lot of you are tired. So I'll just do a brief intro. My name is Ejiro, and I'm a co-founder and product engineer at Veet. And you can find me on Twitter at @ejirocodes. So I think all of this has been done. One thing left out is I work full-time at a company called Acceptive. And also, I love building products. I love building products end-to-end. You ask me, are you a front-end developer? Are you a back-end developer? I'm a product guy. I just love building things. So I love TypeScript, but I'm not a person that is hard on technology, and I'm not the kind of person that will tell you, oh, if you don't use React, you are doing it wrong. If you don't use Vue, you're doing it wrong. You must use TypeScript, but you must use TypeScript because you need it. Now, guess what? After all this, guess what? No one can guess. I'm getting married, so yeah. And I think she's following online, so if you are there, hi. So yeah. Okay. All right. Thank you very much. We're back to TypeScript. Sorry. So why the heck do we need a type system? Right? First off, how many people have used type if you've used TypeScript before? Okay, if you've not in your life, wow, okay, Okay, it's a skill issue anyway, but we'll get to that. We'll get to that. Now, so back to this. Why do we need a type system, right? Why do you need to write TypeScripts? Why not just do your normal thing, write your JavaScript, your plain old JavaScript? Why do you need to go through all the stress to set up a type system to build code? Anyone who wants to try, why do you need a type system? Okay, let me have you.
For maintainability.
For maintainability. Anyone else?
Type safety prevents some bugs from ever running occurring in your program.
Cool. Yeah. Okay. They're both correct. Part of the reason. But I'll summarize the whole reason of why you need a type system to code as documentation. I mean, think about it. The document might be outdated, but the code can never be outdated. Just think about me, flow with me. You are building a full stack app, and let's say you are the front end dev, you are collaborating with a back end dev, right? Flow with me. Now, what happens when, initially when they were building the sign up form, you had first name, last name, right? And now they are saying, no, you just want to have one input field, full name. It has a space, want to maybe do something with it, but we are moving from first name, last name to just full name. Now, for whatever reason, you were not in the meeting, you missed the meeting, you forgot to catch an update, and now you are still sending first name, last name. It's not working, you're not getting an error. I mean, but something is failing. Now, the developer might give you a documentation, maybe he writes it with Notion, with Postman, and they don't update the schema. Now you are there, you have to communicate with them. How far? It's not working. Jump on a call with them, do some debugging. Oh, yeah, no, we change, you change. Ah, you're not change. Something else changes, breaks the application, you have to go back again and fix it. And you are like on stand up every morning. I'm waiting for the back end dev. I'm waiting for the back-end dev. All in a lie. You know what you're doing. Now, TypeScript solves all of this. Not TypeScript in general, a type system. Now, how we solve this is, even though the documentation the developer is giving to you is outdated, I mean, the code can never lie. The code is like the single source of truth. So even if he has moved from first name, last name to full name, if you have access to the code one, you could see, oh, something has changed. But what happens when you don't have access to the code? The type system can still be made available for you. Now, unified type system. Unified type system is a way of building full stack app. I think one of the most popular projects we have out there is the T3 stack, but I'm not going to dive into that. I'm not a fan of it. I'll talk about it later. But the unified type system is a system where both your client side and your server side, they share the same model based off of your database schema. So when you define your database schema, it becomes the single source of truth for your type definitions. So you don't have to define your database schema and then you are now thinking, okay, front-end person, write an interface for this, and then you'll now write interface first name or interface user, and then you define your interface manually. What happens when you make a mistake, in fact, with one of the characters? Or you have to copy and paste, convert from one to another. So unified type system allows the database schema to be a single source of truth, generates a TypeScript definition for you, and the client consumes that type system, and then everything just works. Everything just works as they ought to. Now, that's a unified type system. Now, why do we need unified type system Why do we even need unified type system? We need it for one, consistent type definition, improve developer efficiency. We talk about this. Reduce redundancy, streamline validation, enhance code quality, easier refactoring, and seamless integration. Now, for consistent type definition, right? Who here has used TypeScript in production before? You used TypeScript in production? Okay. Okay, if you use TypeScript in production in a system where there's a backend server and a front-end client, separate code base, let me see. Okay, how do you get, I'll give someone the mic now. So tell me, how do you get the schema for the business logic? How the database is designed? How the schemas are designed in the database? How do you get those interfaces on your client side? Wants to try? How do you get it? Anyone? Or you people don't define it at all?
The project I worked on, which is in production, in order to get that schema, you'd have to sort of go to the Swagger generated documentation for the backend, because it's a Nest.js project.
Okay.
It's not like it's exactly, you'll be receiving the types on the front end, like something T3 would give you. You're not exactly getting stuff like that in that place.
So you just don't get a documentation?
Yes, you'd have to use a documentation to get the schema and all for that.
So essentially you copy those fields and you create
it. Yeah, kind of like, so that is still maybe manual, right?
I'm sorry.
Yeah, sad.
I'm sorry. Okay, now that's one way to do it, but that's so manual. Now, sharing types between front-end and back-end ensures data structure remain consistent, reducing error. Now, the bad thing about this is, if your schema is not properly defined, I mean, you still have something called first name, and there's no field called first name in the database, and then you are sending it, it's so bad that there's no error at all. You're not just getting the right response. So a project like T3 Stack, created by Theo and the community, actually popularized this pattern, which I kind of like the idea, where the front end and the back end, they live in the same code base. Now, this is a downside to it for me. The client and the server, they must be on the same code base, and then you generate your types, and then you consume it. Now, what happens with a team where they don't just, for whatever reason, they don't want their back-end and front-end to be on the same code base? What happens? So which means a project like this cannot work for them. A system like this cannot work for them. Now, another benefit of unified type system is it improves developer efficiency. Now, you can work more efficiently when you're using the same language across the stack. Now, how it helps you is, for those people who haven't used TypeScript, you may not be able to relate, because TypeScript is, as much as it's a language, it's an experience. How do you feel when VS Code gives you autocomplete? How does it feel? Even if you are using Java, even if you are using plain old JavaScript, that's just TypeScript running under the hood. So TypeScript can either come in the form of TypeScript, the language, can come in the form of JS Doc, or your language server. VS Code is helping you, giving you all those autocompletes. And like, I'm not using TypeScript, I'm using JavaScript for life, sorry. You're using TypeScript one way or the other. You're still using TypeScript. Now, for better collaboration and faster onboarding, you're onboarding into a code base you know nothing about, and you change something one place in a plain old JavaScript project, just change something and then everything is no longer working. I mean, how do you build with confidence? You're now like, is there no documentation here? They tell you the code is the documentation. Right? How do you overcome things like that? But with TypeScript, the code can actually be the documentation when it's properly written. The code can actually be the documentation, and you will have little to no front and back, onboarding on new projects. I'm talking about especially plain old TypeScript projects. It reduces redundancy. Remember, we're not just talking about types, we're talking about a unified type system. It reduces redundancy. I'm guessing this is what we were talking about, right? Swagger Dogs. So you come here, you know, name is required, email is required, role is required, password is required. So you create your type or your interface like this, and then you copy, you paste, and then when something changes, you add a new field, you have to come back, refresh the browser, then you copy, and then you paste. It's sweet, right? But you're suffering. Now, another thing a unified type system does is it streamlines validation and data integrity. Now, with the popularity of libraries like Zod and Valibot, right, you can actually validate data you are getting if it conforms to a particular spec. You can even validate even if the data you are getting is a date. If it is not a date, for example, you can prevent the user from performing some operations. So that's what libraries like Zod do. They help you create strict validation for your TypeScript apps. Now, it helps us build reliable software with JavaScript. Now, imagine how many lines of code we have on VS Code. I mean, if you go to github.com/Microsoft/VS Code, and you were to work on that project, and it's written with plain old JavaScript, no type system, nothing at all, it's going to be hell. It's difficult to work on enterprise-grade software when there's no type system, except you just want to be winging things, or you are, I won't say anything, easier refactoring. Now, one thing I've noticed over time is if I jump on a TypeScript project, even if I'm not the original author of it, I build with so much confidence. I mean, I'm talking about projects that are in production. I refactor them like with the speed of light and with so much confidence because I know I'm using TypeScript and there's a type system in place. I'm just building, I'm breaking, I'm building, and I'm breaking, and TypeScript is there, it's like my body helping me along the way. TypeScript is good. If you don't like TypeScript, I'll say it again, the skill issue. Now, let's play around with code. If you want to follow along, this will be short, very brief. If you want to follow along, you could get this code base, git.new/ts-frontend/ts-backend, and this to get access to a database URL. Now, what I'm going to show to you, I'm going to do a demo for you, right? Is a unified type system that doesn't depend on a particular technology. Now, I was talking about the T3 stack. Now, the problem it has is it solves the problem of building a unified type system between your client and your server, but it depends so much on the React ecosystem such that there's no way to get it done with a framework like, for example, Vue or Angular, for whoever is writing Angular. Right, it makes it difficult for you to adapt because all the tools around this ecosystem are built for React. Now, what I have come up with over the years is this has been months of research, trying and failing and then getting things right. Right, is for me to build my backend service, define my schema, right, and then based on my schema, implement my type definitions on the server side. I'm talking about the backend now. Now flow with me. Then when all that is done, right, I use Swagger to create a YAML file. And then on the client side, what I simply do, not simply, but what I do is I use OpenAPI. I don't know. OpenAPI. I use OpenAPI on on the client side to get those type definition with a pack with one of their generators called TypeScript Axios. So I get all the TypeScript definition, right? So I don't have to, for example, install things like, well, I have to install Axios, but it comes with Axios install. I just have to run npm install, right? So it creates an auto-generated type schema for me. I import it to build my services that I use to talk to my backend service. So I create a service on my front end based off of that type schema, and then all I need to do is to import it. And now what happens is, when I make a change on the backend, or every time I'm starting the project, I run a script, right? If the database schema changes, it lets me know on the client side, gives me a red squiggly line, there's an error here, I know something is wrong, and voila, oh, this field is no longer required, or this field is no longer in use. I delete it off, or if there's a new field I need to add, I do the same. So for that, I've created a Next.js app, not the Triangle company. Next.js, the backend framework, not the one that claims to be full stack. Yes, Next.js, the backend framework. Next.js, thank you. Now, what I have installed here is, I have my Prisma. I have Prisma installed, right? I just have one module, users module, and then I kept it simple. Okay, now you could see my dependency. There's nothing much here. These are just standard dependencies. I have NestSwagger, which is important. I have my Prisma client, and I don't think there's any other unique dependency here that's peculiar to what we are doing. So it's just a simple Next.js project, but the most important part of it pertaining to what we are doing is the Prisma package, and then also Nest Swagger, which is a wraparound Swagger. Now, what I'll do is I'll just close this. I'll stop my server, and then I will run it again. Right? Now, when I run it, because I have... Okay, let me run it. Now, when I run it, because I have Swagger set up, if I go to /Swagger, it will give me the URL to my Swagger doc. So if I go here or click on it, I have just a standard blank page. Now, if I go to /Swagger, if I go here, I'll see my normal Swagger docs, my DTO, my properties that are required. Normally, what I'll do is I'll copy this, create an interface, and then move on with my life. But that's stressful, and I've had lots of issues working with a new developer I worked with, because they were always changing the schema according to the business requirements anyway, but it was frustrating. So now, this is standard Swagger docs, nothing new here. But if I go to this URL, right? Let me be sure. Said I have 9 more minutes. Okay, now I'll click on this URL again. Okay. And then I go to /swagger-yaml. Now, you could see I have the type schemas here for my create user DTO, update user DTO, properties that are required, and the ones that are not required. Clear enough, right? So this is just like a JSON, but not a JSON, a YAML, YAML int markup, that's the meaning of YAML, a YAML file that defines my schema. If I go to my front end, this is a React, I'll zoom in. This is an SDS mono repo, turbo repo, with a lot of yada, 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 and bunch of setup. Now, I try to make this as complex as possible so that I'm not just giving something that is different from what people actually use in production. I try to make it production-grade setup. So essentially what we use at where I work. So I have this file. If you can move the video downwards. Okay, thank you very much. Okay, I have this script here I call apigeneration.sh. Now all it does is, this is all it does. So this is the command it does. It runs OpenAI generates. OpenAI generator generates the link to your Swagger YAML file, and then I'm using a TypeScript Axios generator, and then I'm saving it in an output directory called packages client /API. So if you actually go to packages client API, all this code here, they're auto-generated. So if I run this script, that's essentially what it will run here. So this command here. I just decided to put this in a script so it makes things easier to run. Now, if I run this script, if I run OpenAPI, sorry, I didn't get the question. OpenAPI, anytime I use OpenAI, it's OpenAPI, sorry. Okay, now if I run the script, I say script slash this, right? What it does is it will rebuild my clients. Now, the reason why there's no change is because nothing has actually changed. It rebuilds my clients, right? And then I have this bunch of files. I have API, I have base.ts, common, and all of this. All these things in API, they're auto-generated. But I have C-sharp setup, but that's by the way. But the most important thing about it is when I come to, I could create, for example, a TypeScript file, right? And all the TypeScript file would do would be to import what's called default API. If you don't give it a name. You could actually name it from your server side, but if you don't name it, it's called default API, right? I pass my config, I pass my base path, which is like your Azure base URL, and then I pass my API client. Now, what this does is it's automatically building a service for me to interact with my backend directly. So all I have to do here, for example, is to return my controller, but you could do a bunch of stuff with this, but what I decided to do was to return my controller, which is user controller. And now from the front end, this is me importing the create user service or hooks, whatever you want to call it. Now, if I hover over it, you could see I'm not just getting what I typed here. This is not coming from my own writing. This is coming from what I generated. So my packages slash clients. So I have name, email, password, and row. Type system already defined for me. All this already defined for me. Now you could see I did not get to write any of this code. I did not get to write it. Now, let me just show you the most important part of this, so I'm done. Now let's say on my back end, I'll be fast. On my back end, I go to my user entity. I no longer want name for whatever reason. And then I'll save, I'll go to my create user DTO. I no longer want name. So name is not defined. So I'll go to finally the single source of truth, which is my Prisma schema. Name already commented out. Now I'll run Prisma generates NPX. Sorry if you've not used Prisma, but I'm essentially generating my TypeScript definition. See it as that way. I've run my generate, so which means name is no longer a field there, right? I'll come to my front end, run the script again, right? And then you could see, voila, there's an error. Name is showing red. And then the good thing about this is you could build a backend service for whatever you like. I mean, there's a Sales.js Nest, there's a Sales Swagger package for this. It's essentially Swagger and OpenAI, OpenAPI. There's nothing locking you to a particular ecosystem. And that's why I like this setup. There's nothing locking you to the point where you have to, if you build your apps with something like T3 stack, you will have to deploy to Vercel. You may decide to deploy elsewhere if you like the headache, but essentially it's locked in to deploy on Vercel. But with this, deploy on AWS, Cloudflare, whatever the hell you like to deploy on. And that's the beautiful thing about this setup. So with this, I believe I have been able to at least convince you. It is a skill issue, I keep telling people, because I've been up by 1 a.m. today, writing all this demo, front end and back end, just to show you this. It takes a lot of sweat, but when you get it right, there's a whole lot of benefits that TypeScript could provide. Thank you very much. I'll go back to my slide. I don't think I have anything left there. But just in case. Okay, I don't. Okay, so that's it. Thank you very much. Yeah, question? Okay.
Because I have a question. Yeah, whatever. Does TypeScript run on the server or in production?
No, TypeScript is actually a dev dependency.
Okay, so why wasn't it just a VS Code extension at the end? Why was it now in a programming language?
Yeah, well, I think we'll have to ask the authors, but... Oh, you want me to answer the question? Sure. Why is it not? Okay. It's not a skill issue, but I think it can end as a... I'll say it can't just end as a VS Code extension, because being a programming language, TypeScript has evolved so much up to the point of... I don't know if anyone has seen the library effect. It's a TypeScript library effect. Now you see these people, they've spent countless number of hours working so hard on building a TypeScript library off of the TypeScript language. They're trying to standardize TypeScript according to them. But if you see how beautifully it is written, although you know this thing will suffer me a bit, but if I get it right, it can create a system for you to work outside of just your VS Code or an extension, right? It becomes part of your tooling that you could use anywhere. I mean, TypeScript run, even there are type checks on server when you are deploying. It runs on the server, catches an error, your deployment fails, and you have to fix it. You get the point. So that it should, it has, it can't just stay as an extension because it works outside of your code editor.
All right. Yeah, that was a very nice demo. Thank you so much for sharing that. So I was just thinking whether it could positively affect maybe my Postman collection. Give me like a very nice documentation using Postbot with the right types and everything. And with what you just showed now, I know you could, but I just wanted you to confirm, like especially with the open API, I can maybe generate a Postman collection and everything is on point, body documentation, because Postman has this new Postbot that auto-generates documentation from any endpoint. So have you tried that?
No, I haven't tried that. Where I work, what we do is there's a way for you to pass all the props you need, all the description, essentially create a documentation off of the Swagger docs, become so comprehensive. But I understand what you are saying, but where I work, we hate Postman for whatever reason. It's too heavy.
But I know it can work, and maybe it's something I would like to experiment with. We can talk later.
Okay. I have a question. Yeah, and it's kind of like a.
Please, the last question.
Yeah, and it's kind of like yeah. Thank you. And it's kind of like you validating if whether or not I'm correct here. So, yeah, we have a separate backend code base and a separate frontend code base, both TypeScript. Yeah.
Yes.
Now, the backend makes a change, in the, like maybe the API is now returning a new JSON object with a different schema. Now, on the frontend that I'm currently running. You are saying that OpenAPI would automatically check the Swagger once that's been pushed, and then it will update the type for me in my own front-end code base.
Okay, now, if you are a full-stack developer, which means you're most likely running your back-end and front-end on the same machine, so you get the instant change, right? Anything that has not been pushed to production cannot reflect and break your own change if you're working with an endpoint that has been deployed, you understand? So when they deploy that change and then you run that script, you automatically get the change they made.
Do I have to run the script? Okay, makes sense.
Yeah, you have to run. You can just make it part of your NPM run dev.
Yeah, makes sense. Thanks.
Clear enough. Thank you very much.
Whew. Wow. I'm not even going to lie. All the sessions so far has been amazing, power-packed, amazing speakers so far. Please, let's give a round of applause for all the speakers that have spoken so far. A round of applause for all the speakers that have spoken so far, please. Thank you. Okay, let's do something quickly. Can we all stand up?